Esteemed guests, welcome to the investiture ceremony of Minouche Shafik, the 20th president of Columbia University in the city of New York. By tradition, the presidential inauguration begins with the procession of the academic divisions. Please welcome the first division of the academic procession, led by the senior leadership of the university. And now, the University Senate. Esteemed guests, the deans and president affiliates of the university, representing the following schools and colleges: Columbia College, the Fu Foundation School of Engineering and Applied Science, Barnard College, the School of General Studies, the School of Professional Studies, the School of the Arts, the School of International and Public Affairs, the School of Social Work, the College of Dental Medicine, Columbia Business School, Columbia Journalism School, the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation, Teachers College, Columbia Climate School, Columbia Law School, the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, the School of Nursing, the Mailman School of Public Health, the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. Please welcome the faculties of the university and the professors emeriti of the university. Please welcome the trustees and senior leadership of affiliated corporations. Please welcome the second division of the academic procession, including delegates from educational institutions and learned societies and other distinguished guests. Thank you. Esteemed guests, please welcome the third and final division of the academic procession, led by Honorary Head Marshal Amy E. Hungerford, Executive Vice President for Arts and Sciences and Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. Please welcome the co-presidents of the Native American Council, Eva Brander Blackhawk and Hannah Jimenez. And now, today's presiding officers, Katrina A. Armstrong, Chief Executive Officer of Columbia University Irving Medical Center, Executive Vice President for Health and Biomedical Sciences, and Dean of the Faculties of Health Sciences and the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, alongside Dennis A. Mitchell, Interim Provost and Professor of Dental Medicine at the Columbia University Medical Center. Please welcome the Presidential Search Committee members. And now, the Trustees Emeriti of the University. Esteemed guests, please welcome the trustees of Columbia University, led by co-chairs of the Board of Trustees, David Greenwald and Claire Shipman. And now, please welcome today's ceremonial presenters. Sheena Wright, First Deputy Mayor of New York City. Eugenia Lean, Vice Provost for Faculty Affairs. Anne D. Thornton, Vice Provost and University Librarian. Jonathan Levine, Co-Chair Emeritus of the Board of Trustees. Bruce Gomain, University Senate Executive Committee Member. And Madame Christine Lagarde, President of the European Central Bank. The Columbia Mace signifies the University President's authority. Our mace bearer is Lisa Carnoy, Chair of the Columbia Alumni Association, CAA, and Chief Emerita of the Board of Trustees. Esteemed guests, please welcome the 20th President of Columbia University in the City of New York, Minouche Shafik. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Eva Brander Blackhawk, and I am of the Timok tribe of Western Shoshone and a senior at Columbia College. I will be speaking today on behalf of the Native American Council at Columbia to offer a land acknowledgement and reflection on the important role Indigenous people have played throughout Columbia's history. First, I will give a brief prayer in my language of the Shoshone. This prayer was given to me by Samuel Bronco. If I may ask for those who can to please stand. Dame Witsa Za Nasunka, Dama Apa, Nomi Nama Puisi, Dama Za, Suntahai Kante, Supe Wihu, Nama Witsa Za Nesukansoi. Thank you, everyone. You may be seated.
Osio Negada, Hana Dawadoa, Tasquasawu Yawade Tieda, Dawakwa Awatessa, New York, Janelle, Columbia, Digadegulaguaski, Wado. Hi, everybody. My name is Hannah Jimenez. I'm a member of the Cherokee Nation Tribe of Oklahoma, and I am from Tahlequah, Oklahoma. I'm an undergraduate senior at Columbia University, and I am speaking and serving alongside Eva as co-president of the Native American Council. We would like to read a land acknowledgement from the plaque put on campus in 2016. We recognize the Lenne Lenape and Wappinger Indigenous peoples whose ancestral homelands this campus is built upon and whose presence on this land since time immemorial is too often forgotten. We insist this history must be remembered and honored by virtue of our sitting, standing, learning, and growing on lands that belong to them, end quote. Reflecting on recent years, we recognize the progress Indigenous students past and present have made here at Columbia, such as urging Columbia to recognize Indigenous Peoples Day instead of Columbus Day for the first time in 2020, and opening IndigiHouse on 113th Street. Amidst all of these accomplishments, we know there is still progress yet to be made, and we also know and must recognize that Indigenous people play a central role in shaping all of our collective futures.
We hope that this land acknowledgement can encourage everyone to learn more about the vibrant and present Indigenous community here at Columbia, throughout New York, and throughout all the ancestral homelands of the Lenape. We are still here, as we always have been and always will be. But acknowledgement is only the first step. On this day, we are excited about a historic new beginning for Columbia. We look forward to the support of our new president as our Indigenous community here at Columbia continues to grow and flourish. We extend our sincerest congratulations to President Shafik and want to thank everyone for being here on this historic day.
It is with utmost honor and privilege that I welcome each of you here this morning on this truly remarkable occasion, the investiture of Dr. Nemat Minouche Shafik, the 20th president of Columbia University in the city of New York. Please let me first thank the children of the school at Columbia for their beautiful welcoming song. And our Native American Council co-presidents, Eva Brandon Blackhawk and Hannah Jimenez, for their meaningful prayer and opening words for today's ceremony. On behalf of the entire community, I extend a very warm welcome to President Shafik's family, her husband, Raphael, her children, her mother, Maissa Shafik. It is my very great pleasure to welcome our esteemed president. It's my esteemed pleasure to welcome President Emeritus Lee C. Bollinger and Jean Magnana Bollinger. We are so delighted to have you here with us today. Welcome to all of our trustees and trustee emeriti, our world-renowned faculty, our dedicated staff, our unparalleled students, our amazing alumni, our valued neighbors, community leaders, and elected representatives, and a big welcome to all of you joining us via live stream from across the globe. Dr. Armstrong and I hereby begin this Investiture exercise on the fourth day of October, 2023.
President Shafik, we begin this ceremony with a collection of most sincere welcoming words from all parts of our community. We are joined today by Professor and Vice Provost Eugenia Lean, representing our faculty, by our university librarian, Ann Thornton, representing our staff, by our former board chair and esteemed alum, Jonathan Levine, representing our alums across the world, and by a general studies student and member of the University Senate, Bruce Gomain, representing our students. We are honored also to have with us two distinguished leaders to welcome you to our beloved extended community. It is great pleasure that I introduce a video message now from Congressmember Adriano Espaillat, serving New York's 13th Congressional District, followed by remarks from Sheena Wright, the first Deputy Mayor of New York City.
Congratulations to Dr. Minouche Shafik on becoming the first woman to lead Columbia University in the school's 268 years history. You are a trailblazer and a global leader who is engaged with our community because you understand the importance of education in addressing some of the most pressing challenges in our communities today. Today is a tremendous day of your storied career, the history of Columbia, and our community. I look forward to working with you further in this new capacity as we continue to uplift New York students and their families. Thank you so much for your commitment to our community. And again, I look forward to working with you and the Columbia University family. Thank you and keep the faith.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm Sheena Wright. I am the first deputy mayor of the city of New York. And I'm here to give official greetings, congratulations, and welcome to President Shafik on behalf of the City of New York and the mayor. President Shafik, I know you spoke to Mayor Adams on your very first day in office, and we are so thrilled by your leadership and excited to partner with you. You are now the caretaker of one of the most important institutions in the city of New York, which is, as we can arguably say, one of the most important cities on the globe. Yes, we are New York. Not just for the academic scholarship, the economic engine that you are in the city, and the placemaking and shaping that we have done in the city through all of the spaces that Columbia occupies. It is an awesome responsibility. I also want to welcome you as a Columbian. I walked through these gates as a college freshman, 16 years old, And I have to say, you would not have a Columbia welcome without protest. It would not be authentic. So get used to it. Yes. A graduate of the law school and a trustee, the influence that this institution has and will have on young minds and future leaders is another awesome responsibility. I thank the Board of Trustees for your selection. Thank President Bollinger for giving you an awesome foundation and passing the baton with a steady hand. With the awesomeness of the responsibility I've just described, I also say that we have the utmost confidence in your leadership, not only because of your distinguished professional background and the accomplishments that you have completed, but also as a woman and a woman of color in fields that were predominantly and sometimes exclusively the province of men. Thank you. And also because I have seen the love and affection you have for your family and them for you. Columbia has an amazing legacy and an undoubtedly bright future. And I look forward to working with you to further the mission of this university and the city of New York. Thank you.
On behalf of the entire faculty, it is my distinct honor and pleasure to extend to you, President Shafik, a warm and enthusiastic welcome on the occasion of your investiture. I welcome you both in my role as a Vice Provost for Faculty Affairs and as a faculty member of the Arts and Sciences since 2001. As a historian by training, I'm always attentive to significant transformation and new directions. Your appointment as a president of Columbia University, a renowned economist and an Egyptian-born British-American woman, constitutes historic change and promises to be groundbreaking. These past few months, the excitement among the faculty has been palpable. Your distinguished career, marked by remarkable expertise, visionary leadership, and an unwavering commitment to the pursuit of knowledge, makes you an exceptional choice to guide our institution at this moment in time. We are a passionate and dedicated faculty. We look forward to working alongside you for the continuation of the research and educational excellence that defines our institution. We are confident that your tenure will usher in an era of innovation, collaboration, and ongoing distinction. May your journey at Columbia be filled with success, fulfillment, and the enduring partnership of the faculty.
The community of more than 13,000 staff at our university are passionate about upholding the highest standards for education and research in classrooms, clinics, laboratories, libraries, offices, and every part of our life together. We prepare food in dining halls, recruit and welcome new students and faculty, and conserve rare books for future scholars. We shovel snow in winter, curate arts programs, install new technologies, and amplify our message to the world. We keep our campuses safe. In our great diversity, we share a common commitment to the university's mission and to higher education at large. President Shafik, you have already begun sharing your appreciation for the role each of us plays which only deepens our sense of loyalty in the pursuit of excellence. I am humbled and honored to be here today representing Columbia's dedicated staff. With excitement for this moment and the new beginning you are bringing us, on behalf of all staff, I extend our warmest welcome to you. We know that you are counting on us. Together, we will write the next chapter in the history of Columbia University, and I have no doubt that it will be a story of significant impact and inspiration for many generations to come.
On this historic occasion, it is an honor to represent the more than 385,000 living alumni of our alma mater. For alumni, the inauguration is a reaffirmation of our commitment to the pursuit of knowledge and to the ideals of our institution. It is a reminder that education is a lifelong endeavor, and that our role as alumni is intertwined with the continued growth and success of our beloved university. President Shafik, the promise of your presidency fills our academic community with optimism, and we eagerly anticipate the transformative changes you will bring. Having had the privilege of witnessing the growth and evolution of our university, I can say undeniably that your vision aligns perfectly with the values and the aspirations that define us. As we welcome President Shafik to her esteemed role, let us all rekindle our own dedication to the values and principles that our education instilled in us. Let us be ambassadors of the transformative power of education, champions of intellectual curiosity, and stewards of a brighter future. On behalf of all alumni, I extend our warmest welcome to President Minouche Shafik.
Today, we gather here to celebrate a momentous occasion in the history of Columbia University, a university that has always stood at the forefront of education, innovation, and progress. We come together not only to welcome a new leader, but to embrace the next iteration of our institution's journey. As a student speaker, it is my privilege to represent the voices and aspirations of my peers. We, as students, are the torchbearers of Columbia's rich heritage. We are the beneficiaries of the knowledge passed down through generations. President Shafik, in your hands, we entrust not only the legacy of Columbia University, but also the aspirations and dreams of countless individuals who come here seeking knowledge, wisdom, and inspiration. We are excited about the journey ahead, excited to learn, grow, and contribute. Together, under your leadership, we will write the next chapter of Columbia and Columbia's history, one that will undoubtedly be filled with innovation, compassion, and unprecedented transformation. President Shafik, we extend our warmest welcome and our fullest support as you embark on this incredible journey as the 20th president of Columbia University. May your time here be marked by inspiring collaboration and boundless success. We look to you to lead us in fostering a sustainable, inclusive, and equitable environment where all members of our rich and diverse community can thrive. We're honored to stand beside you within this great institution as we set the example and shape the future together. Thank you and congratulations, President Minouche Shafik.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. But I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line. I'm in a New York state of mind. I've seen all the movie stars in their fancy cars and their limousines. Been high in the Rockies under the evergreens. But I know what I'm needing, and I don't want to waste more time. I'm in a New York state of mind. It was so easy living day by day, out of touch with the rhythm and blues. But now I need a little give and take. The New York Times, the Daily News, comes down to reality, and it's fine with me, cause I let it slide. I don't care if it's Chinatown or on Riverside. I don't have any reasons, I left them all behind. I'm in a New York state of mind.
Thank you to student performers Notes and Keys for that beautiful rendition of New York State of Mind. I am pleased to welcome to the podium longtime colleague and friend of President Shafik, President Christine Lagarde. As the former managing director of the International Monetary Fund and the current president of the European Central Bank, Madame Lagarde's contributions to global economics and her commitment to fostering stability and progress have earned her a widespread admiration. She continues to be the leading voice in shaping the economic future of Europe and the world. Her dedication to public service and her advocacy for economic inclusivity make her an inspiration to many. And we are privileged to have her with us at this auspicious day.
Bonjour, buenos dias, and good morning to all of you. Dear Board of Trustees, esteemed members of this institution, dear distinguished guests, et ma chère amie, Baroness Dame Minouche. Like a few others here today, I have had the very good fortune of working with you, Minouche, plotting with you always for good, and laughing with you over the years, both as a colleague and as a friend. This is a privilege that many of the people attending today have not yet had. So I would like to take this opportunity to introduce to them the person that I have been lucky to know and love. But before I do that, I will mention a shared connection on this campus. Not far from where I stand here sits the famous and beautiful sculpture of Alma Mater. And if you know where to look, you will discover an owl hidden within the folds of her clothing. As some of you might know, when it comes to central banking, monetary policy, central bankers are often divided between the doves and the hawks. When I became president of the European Central Bank, everybody was interested in this new face, and they all wanted to know whether I would be a dove or a hawk. And I said, you know what? I will try to be an owl, which is the symbol of wisdom. And you know who was the first friend who sent me an owl? Now, rest assured, not a real owl. A little representation, a beautiful little sculpture of a white owl. It was my friend Minouche. By the way, that tells you a lot about Minouche, paying attention to people and being generous. Minouche, there are so many of your qualities that I would single out and praise. But I had to pick one, and I picked wisdom, your wisdom. You have an insatiable thirst for knowledge, which has proved to be a reassuring ballast for you, no matter what life thrown your way. When you were a child, your family was forced to flee Egypt, and almost everything had to be left behind. And thereafter, the words of your father would always remain with you. They can take everything away from you, except your education. You took those words to heart, and gifted with a rare intelligence, that lifelong drive for learning has taken you far. A true Renaissance person, your wide array of interest has helped you transcend the worlds of policymaking and academia in all corners of the world. And you have marked a series of firsts along the way, of which becoming Colombia's first female president is only the latest. But your learning has not been confined to your readings and writings. Throughout your career, in a mark of true wisdom, you have tirelessly applied it towards improving the life of other people. And this is deeply rooted. Before your family left Egypt, you had once visited the village of your mother's family. And there, you saw girls who looked just like you, but who, instead of going to school, had to spend their days working outside in the field. And the question stayed with you. Why had you had the opportunity to go to school while they had not? Early on, you recognized the power of ideas to shape the world. Ideas inform policies, and policies determine people's chance of success in life. What you once eloquently called the architecture of opportunities. When we worked at the IMF together, I saw firsthand how your actions were continuously guided by the desire to improve the welfare of people whose lives policies would ultimately affect. If Monsieur Montaigne was still around today, I have no doubt that he would call you an honnête homme. Or maybe he would be wise enough to call you an honnête dame. It makes perfect sense then that you would become president of this proud institution, for the same quality also shines throughout Colombia's past and present. For over 250 years, Colombia has never satiated its thirst for expanding the boundaries of knowledge. And it is no surprise that the university has been home to 87 today Nobel laureates. Bravo. And Colombia's core curriculum, in which freshmen and sophomore students, regardless of their major, read and debate the works of classical authors, is emblematic of the university's wider ethos of combining humanities with science to create a well-rounded education. One does not need to look far to see this. Just across from me stands the Butler Library, and on its edifice, I can see the names of famous philosophers and poets of old, from Aristotle to Virgil. But I also understand that more recently, a few female names have also appeared up there on occasions. Colombia, too, has always set its sight on shaping the world for the better. It cannot help but do so, situated as it is, right at the heart of the world's most international of cities. And certainly given the complexity of the challenges facing us, from the climate and environmental crisis to geopolitical fragmentations, our world needs groundbreaking ideas to craft innovative policies now more than ever. Let there be no doubt, universities like Columbia serve as a powerful engine for creating those state-of-the-art ideas. And I understand that one of Minouche's primary goals is to make it easier for Columbia academics to bring their ideas out into the world to help propel that change. That's only one challenge for you, Minouche, but there are others. Colombia is world-renowned for many things. Winning at football has not been one of them. This might have to do with the fact that in the past, players tended to be more gifted in other fields. I learned that while the young Jack Kerouac did not break any records playing on the field with the Colombia Lions, he did manage to break his leg on the second game. Now, I hear that he stuck to writings after that. And I also know that the tide has been turning in recent years, and in 10 days, you will have your big homecoming game against the Penn Quakers. So the ultimate test of success for you, my friend, will be for the Columbia Lions to become Ivy League champions for the first time in no less than 60 years. I know you can do anything when you put your mind to it, so make them roar again. I want to wish your husband, Rafael, all the children, and of course your mother, who is here with us today, all the best during your time here at Columbia. Stay tuned. There will be courage, there will be intelligence, there will be drive, energy, and leadership, I can assure you. Thank you.
It is now my very great pleasure to introduce the co-chairs of our Board of Trustees, David Greenwald and Claire Shipman, who will present our new president with the symbols that reflect our rich traditions, grounded in the values that reflect our present day.
President Shafik, it is now my great privilege on behalf of the trustees to formally welcome you as only the 20th president of Columbia University in the city of New York, next in succession to a long line of distinguished persons. As you have witnessed here today, you now have the loyal, enthusiastic, and strong support of all trustees, faculties, staff, alumni, students, and our extended community. In celebration of your appointment, I now present you with the chair of the presiding office of Columbia University. Once owned by Benjamin Franklin, this chair has made many appearances at ceremonial occasions dating back to the 1800s. Its one remaining role is to preside over presidential inaugurations. On behalf of the trustees, I also present you with the presidential keys. They're a little heavy. These keys symbolize the open doors of all the academic buildings. We now place these under your trust and care. We are confident that under your leadership, Columbia will unlock many more doors to opportunity, to knowledge, and to growth, and we couldn't be more excited for all that is to come. Claire?
I have a lot to say, but first I want to say there's a lot of history we're talking about here today. And one incredible part of Columbia's reputation, for those of you who are new to campus, is that we welcome all voices at all times, especially voices of dissent. So this is part of the Columbia tapestry for people who have not experienced it. And thank you all for being here. It is now my great honor by the authority of the trustees to bestow upon you a copy of the original 1754 charter, under the terms of which we charge you with administering the affairs of this university, and in so doing, providing leadership for our faculty, our staff, and our students in pursuit of education and the advancement of knowledge. Okay, that made me nervous. At least it was a copy of the charter. I was like, what, I don't want to hold the real thing. Today we gather on this auspicious occasion, as you've probably figured out by now, to celebrate the investiture of a remarkable individual, Dr. Nemat Minouche Shafik, as the new leader of our esteemed institution. And I have to tell you, it is with profound pride and no small amount of humility that I stand before you as a trustee of this university today with the privilege of introducing our first woman president. It's taken a little bit of time, but here we are. But more importantly, I want all of you to know we are introducing a visionary leader whose achievements have distinguished her as a beacon of excellence in the realms of academia, economics, and public service. I think you heard some of this from Christine Lagarde, but one thing you should know is that every institution in which Minouche has served or that she's led has been left transformed. And always, on every mission, however different they've been, there's been a common thread. She's been driven by her fundamental passion, a vision for basic economic equality and for a new social contract for our times, one that's grounded in shared human values. Most critically, and I think you will all learn this about Minouche, she doesn't lead for the sake of leading or amassing power. She asks why, which is increasingly what is expected of universities. President Shafik's unparalleled career and unwavering commitment to the pursuit of knowledge, social progress, and innovation makes her the embodiment of the values that define our institution, all of it. She understands that Columbia will be judged both for its exceptional academic prowess and its relevant engagement with the pressing problems of the world. As we embark on this journey under her leadership, the trustees stand before everyone to affirm the extraordinary qualities that have brought her to this momentous role. This is a woman with exceptional intellect, unyielding dedication, and profound compassion, a global sensibility, but at the same time, an incredible commitment to community. And she is poised to guide us to a future of limitless potential. President Shafik, I love saying that. President Shafik, it is with deep gratitude and most sincere excitement that I now offer you the chance to speak.
So I wanted to begin by thanking everyone in the Columbia community for the incredibly warm welcome, including this very warm day that has been arranged as I get to know this institution. Getting to know you and everyone here has been an incredible privilege and a joy. I'm grateful to the trustees for giving me this extraordinary opportunity. I'm indebted to the students, the faculty, the staff, who could not be more open and engaging. I'm thankful to the alumni who've been so welcoming and so eager to help. I have never met a group of people more passionate about their alma mater. Thank you, Alma. I'm appreciative of our larger community and its leaders, including First Deputy Mayor Wright, Congressman Espiat, and presidents and representatives of so many universities who are here today. The impact of our neighbors, both in New York and across the world, has shaped Columbia into the incredible institution it has become. To all the people who worked so hard to make this day possible, and this week possible, I'm very grateful. None of this would have happened without you. And I'm deeply appreciative of my friend Christine Lagarde for her generous words. Christine, I have learned so much from working alongside you. How to lead with clarity and compassion. How to take incoming fire with grace. And how to always do the right thing, even when it's very hard. Your being here today is incredibly meaningful to me. Lee, President Bollinger, or should I refer to you by the affectionate student moniker of Presbo? Thank you. Thank you for your leadership, your legacy, and the gracious way that you and Jean have welcomed me and my family here. In preparing for today, I, of course, read Lee's original inaugural address, and it was full of wisdom and wit and vision, rooted in warmth and admiration for Columbia's past and its great history. Lee spoke about Columbia as the quintessential great urban university, an institution engaged, internationally diverse, rooted in academic excellence and tradition, and a place that's both in and of New York. He pledged to invest in its strengths, and invest he did, in ways that have profoundly shaped the future of the university. Institutions like Columbia, which have been around for centuries, benefit enormously from different layers of leadership, each of which brings a different set of characteristics. Sometimes I think of them a bit like geological strata, each with its own properties. The Bollinger strata at Columbia will be one of growth, greater diversity, intellectual innovation, and lasting impact on the world. Now, my mother, Mesa, is also here today. And I owe so much to her, always supporting me throughout my life. She's the one who patiently drove me to those various local libraries in my childhood, satisfying my passion for reading and learning. She intuitively understood what that other famous Columbian, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, said. Reading shaped my dreams, and more reading made my dreams come true. My father, Talat, is no longer with us. When I was growing up, he was quite a tough taskmaster. When I came home from school with straight A's, he would say, "Is that the best you can do?" Well, I think if he were with us here today, he would agree, indeed, that this is the best I could do. To my husband, Raphael, my big love, thank you for being infinitely supportive while encouraging me to be the best version of myself and being a kind sounding board when I'm struggling to achieve that. And to my children, thank you for keeping my feet firmly rooted on the ground and reminding me that no matter what else is going on in the world, the practicalities of life must continue to be addressed, whether that's changing diapers, putting food on the table, making trips to the emergency room. And there was always, of course, the constant need for what the British call tidying up. But mainly, I want to thank you for the infinite joy that you've brought to our lives. There are also many colleagues and friends and special guests who've gathered here who've played a role in my personal and professional life. You know who you are. I would not be standing here if I weren't standing on the shoulders of many, many giants. Or, as the Beatles said, I get by with a little help from my friends. So, how did I get here? When I was young, if you said to me you would end up becoming president of Columbia University, I would have laughed in disbelief. I'm a Leo whose favorite color is blue, but I don't think that featured in the selection criteria of the search committee. One part of the job description that I think might have worked in my favor is that you were looking for someone who believed deeply in the power of education. I am unusually a third generation PhD, but there was nothing automatic about that outcome. As Christine said, my family started from scratch after losing everything in Egypt in the 1960s, and we started in the American South. I was a child of the desegregation era. I went to more schools than I can remember. Local libraries and a few wonderful teachers were my salvation. But from very early on in life, I was acutely aware of the randomness of opportunity. My husband, Raphael, had a very different experience. He was the first person in his family to finish high school. And by the serendipity of a scientist who was working in a lab that he was working in himself, he went on to do a PhD himself. My mother didn't go straight to university, but after having children, went to a community college and then went back to university, became a school teacher, and then a head of a school herself. As Christine said, I often quote my father, who always said, they can take everything away from you except your education. And my own life experience has made me cherish the role that education plays in social mobility and spreading opportunity. Education is the foundation on which a just society is built. And as an economist, I would add, it is the best way to make sure that all of the talents in our society flourish to everyone's benefit. A person's destiny should not be determined by where and to whom one is born, and universities play a vital role in altering destinies. So I wanted to focus my remarks today on what does the world need from a great university in the 21st century? Let me start by saying the obvious. Columbia is a great university. It is an institution of higher learning that dates back to 269 years. We have 17 schools and 4 affiliates spread out over 4 campuses and a network of global centers around the world. For centuries, Colombians have ranked among the most celebrated individuals in government, the arts, business, technology, media, the academy. Nearly 90 of us have won Nobel Prizes, and our numbers include even more. Today, Professor Lewis Bruce was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry It was for his discovery and synthesis of quantum dots. His work, like that of so many other Colombians, has transformed our lives in countless ways, literally illuminating television screens and computer monitors, guiding doctors and biochemists in mapping biological tissue, and enabling the proliferation of LED bulbs. So on behalf of the entire Columbia community, I extend my warmest congratulations to Professor Bruce. On behalf of the entire Columbia community, I wanted to say that. Columbians are also have been five founders of the United States, 4 U.S. presidents, 8 Supreme Court justices, 3 framers of the Constitution, along, of course, with the author of the Indian Constitution, the remarkable Ambedkar. And of course, we are home to the Pulitzer Prizes. Colombians are proud to rank among our luminaries of the Harlem Renaissance, Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, and Paul Robeson. We are thrilled to call our own the architects of incredibly transformative projects like the Museum of Modern Art, the High Line, and the revival of Lincoln Center. And in the past 3 years alone, 10 alumni have been nominated for Oscars, 7 for Golden Globes, 15 for Emmys, and 19 alumni have worked on Tony Award-winning plays. Colombians have always been pioneers, and we're always ahead of the curve. It was at Columbia that the first medical degree was awarded in the American colonies, that the atom was split, that the first school of social work was built, that the Apgar score, which judges newborn health, was created, and that the phrase global warming was coined. It was also at Columbia that the country's first student-run gay rights group was founded, that a philosophy lecture stopped traffic on Broadway, and that the first television sporting event in the United States was broadcast on NBC. It was a baseball game, in case you didn't know. And now, we have the opportunity to be pioneers yet again. We can be pioneers in redefining the role of a great university in the 21st century. In the past, universities in the classical world were kept separate from the world around them. The ancient universities of the Middle East, Asia, and Africa had their origins in religious traditions. And this academic regalia, which is a little bit hot on a day like today, had its origins in medieval Europe, which kept the clerics warm as they went about their studies, and also made them separate and distinct from their fellow citizens. At Columbia, students wore caps and gowns daily until after the American Civil War. It seemed that any student caught without their robes would be fined 2 shillings for the first offense. And that regalia was designed to make them easier to identify, but also to try and avoid having them tempted by the many vices of New York City. And so, for much of their history, universities like Columbia were cloistered places, preserving knowledge and passing it on to a select few in the next generation. It wasn't until the 19th century that we saw the rise of the modern research university. In this country, this was also at a moment when universities became more engaged with the world around them and more intentional and about the practical application of their research. As many of our own faculty have chronicled, it was at that juncture that American universities locked into what would make them so successful. That special blend of new knowledge and allowing that knowledge to be transferred and developed by other institutions and industries, and training scholars to keep that system flourishing. The result was a kind of intellectual perpetual motion machine that is the envy of the world. And it was a commitment to open inquiry and the rigor of the scientific method and of competition and the free exchange of ideas that made that all possible. And that often came with controversy, as we see today, which made universities a political target. As was said in the Calvin Report in 1967, a good university, like Socrates, will be upsetting. The university is a home and sponsor of critics. Need I say more? It is not itself a critic. A university must sustain an extraordinary environment of freedom of inquiry and maintain an independence from political fashions, passions, and procedures and pressures. Today, universities have expanded access to more people from different backgrounds and different life experiences than ever before. Columbia started as a university for white Christian men. For most of its history, it would have been inconceivable for someone who looked like me to be the president of this great institution. Today, Columbia includes humanity in all its differentiated glory, and our world is so much richer for it. That commitment to diversity and inclusion has made us stronger and better, and is something that we will continue to honor in the future. Which brings me to this moment. What do we want from a great university given the challenges that we are facing? And if I were to imagine a new social contract between universities and society, what would it look like? Let me start with the challenges that we are facing in this moment in history. We're living in a time of great divisions in society between rich and poor, amongst different races and religions, across fundamental values and principles. We see the rise of truculent nationalism and troubling fault lines in democracies across the world. And at a time when our most pressing challenges, such as climate change, require more international agreement,
we see the rise of divisions and nationalism. Yet we're also on the cusp of major technological revolutions like artificial intelligence, neuroscience, quantum, and nanotechnologies, such as today's Nobel Prize. And at the same time, we are rapidly aging and coping with mental health challenges and worsening well-being. And in this context, the first job of universities is to educate citizens and leaders who are comfortable with rigorous debate and possess the skills and knowledge to cope with these challenges. At Columbia, our core curriculum was developed partly in response to the horrors of World War I and the need to build future generations of citizens and leaders. Arguably, we have the most demanding core requirements of any of our peers. And that shared academic experience for nearly all undergraduates introduces them to influential books and ideas in literature, philosophy, science, the arts, and music. And they have to grapple with profound questions that have intrigued great minds and humanity for millennia. And that includes, what does it mean to be human? What kind of life is most worth living? What is just? What is good? What is beautiful? What is the nature of political power and what makes it legitimate? And what is the relationship between the individual and communal life, which is at the heart of the social contract? Our students consider these questions and many more in small classes designed to build community and encourage vigorous debate. And many of them come and do that from very different backgrounds. I'm thinking in particular of our students at the School of General Studies, who bring to these discussions a wealth of non-traditional life experiences. And so that spirit of critical thinking infuses this place, including our teaching of graduate students. Now, as most of you know, the authors of the core had many profound disagreements. Take Hobbes and Rousseau, who had drastically different concepts of human nature. Or Adam Smith and Karl Marx, who differed profoundly on the role of the market and the role of government. Or Fanon and Gandhi, who disagreed on the legitimacy of violence and the struggle for freedom. Or Mary Wollstonecraft, who in large part wrote her seminal work on a vindication of the rights of women in response to Rousseau's backward views on gender equality. At a time of great divisions, the experience of reading and debating texts together creates the foundation for informed and enlightened citizens and leaders. And through their teaching, our faculty get to touch the future and shape the people who will determine it. The second part of the social contract between a great university and society is to create the knowledge that will take humanity forward, whether it's finding solutions to global warming or cancer, and exploring how those technologies affect us and finding ways to preserve our social and cultural history. University research has probably done more to advance human progress than anything else. And I would argue that this is grounded in the pursuit of knowledge for its own sake by curiosity, whether that's in the arts or the sciences. Applied breakthroughs, like the miracle of the COVID-19 vaccine, which was developed with amazing speed, were based on decades of foundational research, including the discovery of mRNA, critical advancements in gene therapy, and work on HIV vaccines. I've also learned from my own experience that some of the best research questions come from the so-called real world. Think of areas like climate, artificial intelligence, the intersection of neuroscience and mental health. Those are fields in which we can show great leadership and contribute in concrete ways to the world beyond the academy without sacrificing investments in other areas of academic excellence. We can also put into practice what we teach and preach by operating a sustainable campus, by applying new technologies to accelerate discovery in our own operations, and by having good mental health practices for our students, our faculty, and our staff. Now, the third pillar of a social contract between a great university is a commitment to community at both the global and local levels. At Columbia, countless faculty, staff, and students are engaged in collaborative efforts, both locally and globally. This includes the umbrella of Columbia Global, with its centers in 11 countries and projects on everything from building resilient cities in the Dominican Republic to using data to catalyze energy investments in sub-Saharan Africa. It also includes the International Center for AIDS Care and Treatment Programs, which has screened nearly 43 million people for HIV worldwide. We've also increased our engagement with communities at our doorstep, across New York City and Upper Manhattan. My favorite story is that of the Columbia Engineering faculty, who helped avert a complete shutdown of the L train when it needed repairs following damage from Hurricane Sandy. And I could also, amazing job, huh? I could also point to the clinics run by our medical students to provide free primary care and mental health services to residents in Washington Heights and Harlem. To be an engaged citizen at Columbia is to be an engaged person globally and locally. And we need to do more of this, and I am eager to make such local and global engagement core to who we are as a university. Now, I hope I've persuaded you that a great university in the 21st century is one that educates citizens and leaders, generates ideas to solve the world's challenges, and is deeply embedded in local and global communities. But how to achieve it? Let me end with a few words on mushrooms, owls, and institutions. Now, you may know that mushrooms are the fruiting body of vast underground networks called mycelia. I would like to grow mycelia across Colombia, nurturing the underground roots that connect the university in all of its seemingly disparate parts. Some of you will know that there are many urban myths about the tunnels under the Columbia campus. Allegedly, they were used to transport patients between buildings of the Bloomingdale Mental Asylum that used to be located here, and also used to move radioactive materials during the Manhattan Project. I have neither of these purposes in mind. What I would like to offer is leadership that provides not only nourishment, but cross-pollination, promoting creativity and flowering in all its forms in our great institution. And I ask of you, as part of this new social contract, to engage wholeheartedly in becoming leaders, developing ideas that matter, and engaging locally and globally. We will ensure that the ground is well fertilized for the future by acting boldly in the present. Now, as Christine mentioned, generations of Columbia students have searched for the owl hidden in the folds of alma mater's gown in the statue behind me. As the legend goes, the first student of each Columbia undergraduate class to find the owl should expect academic greatness. Thank goodness I found it when I was toured here as an applicant for the job. But the image of the owl has deeper significance for me. Like Christine, I too used to be a central banker. And like her, I thought the image of the owl was the best one for thinking about leadership, being observant, trying to be wise. But unlike owls, who tend to be solitary creatures, I want to lead this institution with you every day. As the African proverb says, if you want to go far, go together. And finally, let me say something about institutions. My work as an economist, especially in the world's poorest countries, has made me firmly of the view that what makes a country rich and successful is the effectiveness of its institutions. Jean Monnet, the architect of the European Union, once said, Nothing is possible without people. Nothing is lasting without institutions. I know that strong institutions have to be grounded in clear strategies, efficient and fair processes, and strong measures for measuring progress. And some of those things can sound very boring, but they are the difference between consistent excellence and haphazard outcomes. I want Columbia to be an even stronger institution that can deliver big, audacious goals with confidence and consistency. At a time when many are skeptical about institution, we can build on this tradition. Now would be good. We can build on the concentric rings of familiarity and obligation that make up our world. Universities hold an exceptional place in this order. Our work is to learn and to teach and to dispatch ambassadors of knowledge and talent to the places that need it most. My vision of Columbia is an institution that is a friend to our neighbors, an asset to this institution, and a beacon in this world. So let us forge a new social contract with society and with each other that will make us an exemplar of a great institution, a great university in the 21st century. And we will build this on the legacy of the Colombians who came before us and who lived through us, as our legacy will live on with future generations, nurtured by the commitments that we reaffirm here today. Thank you. Thank you for entrusting me with this great institution that is so beloved by all of us.
Well, President Shafik, we thank you for offering such inspiring words. As we bring this monumental occasion to a close, I would like to extend our heartfelt gratitude to each and every one of you for joining us today to witness the investiture of President Shafik. Today, we have celebrated not only the remarkable achievements of an outstanding individual, but also the bright future that lies ahead for Columbia University.
To everyone here, as we embark upon this next chapter, I first want to say it has been so wonderful to see everybody here who has delivered water to their neighbors. If there's a better example of what President Shafik is trying to do, I can't think of it right now. I also want to say how grateful I am to be part of this incredible chapter. As we embark, let us remain inspired by the ideals of excellence, integrity, and a boundless spirit of discovery, the quest for learning that President Shafik embodies. Let us unite together for the support of her leadership and what it can do for our university, our society, and our world. Let us unite behind our shared mission, a mission to advance education, research, and the betterment of this society that we all hold so dear. With that, I have the unbelievable honor to officially declare this investiture ceremony concluded.
Ron Soucy.